Shakespeare's terms, to adopt or not to adopt, that is the question. In the 206th edition of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction lecture series, we have our own family member, a great friend, and the way he presents things, nobody forgets, Anil Malhotra sir, today. And we are also privileged with the presence of Justice Ram Kumar sir, Justice Ramakrishnan sir, and all of you wonderful participants. So, let us see the process of adoption, the labyrinthine process of adoption, how it can be made easy or should it be made easy? Over to you, Anil sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome participants, friends, honorable judges and colleagues. A very disturbing trend has emerged on social media, which prompted me to go ahead with this. I wrote a piece which the Hindu carried. And I just read one of the messages which I saw on social media. It said, 2 years baby girl and 2 months baby boy. Father and mother expired due to COVID. If anyone interested to adopt, please contact. And there is a mobile number, Brahmin children, please forward to maximum other groups so that help may reach to this helpless, to these helpless children. Now, this is something which has started going around, and the veracity of such messages and the dubious process by which this activity is sought to be carried out and encouraged has been stopped by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. I happened to attend a workshop organized by an NGO and NCPCR also. Both the state commissions of Punjab and Haryana have also cautioned the governments to step up a police vigil that this racketeering or trading of children by unethical means should be stopped immediately. Now, before we go into the nitty-gritties of adoption, and how there are some clashes in opinion between the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act and the Juvenile Justice Care and Adoption of Children Act 2015. We'll first look at the two provisions comparatively, but just to have a very broad perspective of the whole scenario. The law of adoptions, insofar the majority community that is Hindus is concerned, is codified and enacted in the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act of 1956. Now, as far as adoptions per se of orphan, abandoned and surrendered children is concerned, it all starts with Lakshmikant Pandey 1, 2 and 3. But the first is the 1984 decision, 84-2 SEC 244, where Supreme Court said that the government has to enact some kind of a law, some kind of guidelines to prevent the trafficking of children, because India had become a major hub for children to be sold in foreign countries through dubious adoption agencies who were unrecognized and were with very shady antecedents. So initially, to start with, Central Adoption Resource Agency, which is now Central Adoption Resource Authority and a statutory body, came into being. And with India ratifying the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, the UNCRC, emphasizing on the rights of children, and India acceding to the UN Convention on Protection of Children and cooperation in respect of inter-country adoptions, 1993. The process of adoptions, particularly inter-country, went through a very strong and a rigorous transformation, because once India signed the Adoption Convention of The Hague, India per se had to follow international principles of adoption to be at tandem with the law in countries all over the world who had signed the convention and who had options to adopt children from India. So all the beneficial provisions of the Adoption Convention contained in the Adoption Convention of 1993 came to be part of the JJ Act of 2015. Now, the JJ Act initially was of 86, then it was amended in the year 2000, and ultimately in the year 2015, it underwent a very big transformation. And the JJ Act, besides containing a part on juveniles in conflict with law, now contains a separate chapter on rehabilitation and social integration, and an exclusive chapter focusing on adoptions. Now, besides the JJ Act, the JJ Rules 2016 came in, and the most important provisions were the Adoption Regulations 2017, which are probably the Bible of inter-country adoptions in a complete scenario as they exist now. Now, as of now, the way the adoption regulations stand, they not only permit adoption of orphan, abandoned, and surrendered children through recognized adoption agencies and the system of carrying's registration by CARA. It also recognizes domestic adoptions of orphan, abandoned, and surrendered children, and also inter-relative adoptions within the family or outside the family within India. So the JJ Act, now as a secular law, enables any person of any religion to adopt a child irrespective of the dictates of his religion or whatever is the personal law of the parties. And when an objection was raised as to why the provisions will apply to certain communities, particularly the Muslims, which do not permit adoption, in the decision of Shabnam Hashmi by Justice Gogoi, 2014 4 SCC 1, the Supreme Court declared that the Juvenile Justice Act, it was of the year 2000, was a secular law, and any and everybody was free to adopt a child irrespective of his religion. And when the dispute arose whether it is a compulsory mandate or whether it is essential for a person to adopt under the JJ Act, the Supreme Court judgment spelled out very clearly that being a secular law and being an optional law, it is not a compulsory mandate for anybody to adopt the provisions of the JJ Act. You are free to adopt under HAMA. You are free to adopt under JJ Act. It is a choice of an individual. And the parallel which I draw whenever I have asked, you know, ever been asked to assist the court as an amicus, I say, just like you can marry under the Hindu Marriage Act or you can marry under the Special Marriage Act, you can adopt under the HAMA or you can adopt under the JJ Act. So this is the broad scenario under which these two legislations exist. Now, the bone of contention which I see in litigations and in which I have assisted three courts as an amicus in the past 6 months is the difference which comes in the processes of adoption and the role of CARA or the role of a passport officer or the dictate of the JJ Act Does the JJ Act override HAMA? Does HAMA stand out? Does a adoption under HAMA require ratification under the JJ Act? If there is an inter-country adoption, sorry, if there is an intra-country adoption under the provisions of HAMA, can the Child Welfare Committee pick up the child and take the child away, regardless of the adoption having been concluded under HAMA, on the pretext that the JJ Act applies and this procedure has not been complied with? Now, these are litigated areas and they have emerged in judgments in 2020. And the backdrop and the shadow falls directly on what is going on currently in the COVID pandemic. And in the NCPCR workshop, which I attended 2 days ago, I put it to the chairperson of the NCPCR saying that putting up children of parents who have died during COVID, unfortunately, should not be pushed into the adoption process under the JJ Act by declaring them free from adoption, by putting them in a home, by asking for parents to opt. It's a long process. I said, you should first explore the possibility of adoption and rehabilitation of such children within the families themselves. In India, the fabric of social services, social security, and agencies which take care of children, as it happens abroad, is in family networks. We have uncles, aunts, granduncles, aunts, relatives, host of community members, a bevy of parties interested in the family, who will always be happy to take a child of the family within the family itself, giving a comfort level to the child, one, two, making the process simple, and three, doing the process under HAMA to give it the legitimacy of adoption, and four, most importantly, preventing the risk of the child being trafficked or being handed over for money or for other unethical purposes. So this is the composite structure of do's and don'ts of adoption, which I wanted to impress upon today, because this unfortunate pandemic has created unfortunate victims, children who do not even understand what has happened to their parents. So for such children, where is the recourse? Where is the remedy? Where is the answer? Where is the rehabilitation? JJ Act or HAMA? This is the conclusion we would like to take home at the end of the session, subject to what all others have to contribute. Now, first, let us look at how adoption under HAMA takes place. So first of all, HAMA is an act to amend and codify the law relating to adoptions and maintenance among Hindus. And as everybody knows, Hindus means any person who is professing the Sikh religion, the Hindu religion, Buddhist religion, Jain religion are Hindus. Now, sections 5 of the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act says that all adoptions under HAMA shall take place in accordance with the provisions of HAMA, and any adoption in contravention of the provisions of HAMA shall be void, and an adoption which is void, no right shall be created. So section 6 says, what are the requisites of a valid adoption? It says no adoption shall be valid unless the person adopting has the capacity, the person giving has the capacity, the person adopted is capable of being adopted, and the adoption is made in compliance with other conditions of adoption. And section 7 talks of the Hindu capacity of a Hindu to take an adoption. And it broadly says a Hindu shall take an adoption with the consent of his wife, if there is one. And similarly, a Hindu woman will take an adoption with the permission of the husband. And who is capable of giving an adoption under Section 9 is the natural parent, the mother or the father, or the guardian of the child who will have the capacity to give an adoption. And the word guardian is defined in subsection 951A as a person who is a guardian appointed by will or a guardian declared by a court. And court under the Hamma means a civil court, not a family court. So it is a civil court exercising jurisdiction in the territory where the child is located. So whenever there is a person or a parent who is of unsound mind or is not in a position or has renounced the world, then once such a declaration is obtained, such a child can be given in adoption by a guardian appointed by the court. And before giving in adoption, the guardian has to take permission from the court before giving the child in adoption. Obviously, the purpose being to oversee that there is no hanky-panky and there is no commercial element in the adoption. And a person who can be adopted is, no person shall be capable of being taken in adoption unless he or she is a Hindu. He or she is already not been adopted, is not married, and has not completed the age of 15 years. Now, most important is Section 11. Now, 11 says, in every adoption, following conditions shall be satisfied. Namely, if the adoption is of a son, then there is no son. If the adoption is of a daughter, then there is no daughter. If the adoption is by a male, then the person to be adopted is at least 21 years older than the person to be adopted. Sorry, this was in case the person who is adopting is a male and the person to be adopted is a female. Likewise, if the person to be adopting is a female and the person to be adopted is a male, there should be an age gap of 21 years. And the same person cannot be adopted simultaneously. Now, the most important ingredient of a Hindu adoption, which is the fulcrum of the adoption in Hindus, is 11.6. The child to be adopted must be actually given and taken in adoption by the parents or the guardian concerned or under their authority with intent to transfer the child from the family of its birth, or in the case of an abandoned child whose parent is not known, from the place or the family where it has been brought to the family of its adoption, provided that the performance of datta human shall not be essential to the validity of the adoption. Now, what is 11.6 saying? 11.6 is saying the giving, the taking is the most important part of the adoption. Ordinarily speaking, a ceremony of datta human, nothing very specific, is just a priest saying some religious things, but that is also not necessary. So, proof of the parents giving and the proof of the parents taking is essentially going to be the most important element of the adoption. Now, Amma makes such an adoption under Section 12 irreversible. And further, does not require anything to be put in writing, does not require any registration, does not require any notarization. But at the same breath, Section 16 says presumption of a registered document relating to adoption. 16 says, whenever any document registered under any law for the timing in force is produced before a court purporting to record an adoption made and it is signed by the person giving and the person taking an adoption, the court shall presume that the adoption has been made in compliance with the provisions of the Act unless it is disputed. So if the giving and taking ceremony is actually written down, is actually signed by the persons giving and taking, is actually witnessed, is actually notarized and also registered. Now the Registration Act provides no registration. You can get it registered optionally. So the provision of Section 16 says that in such a circumstance, there shall be a presumption in law that the adoption has taken place and it is in compliance with the provisions of law. So it is documented, it is proved, it is per se evidentiary in value, and it carries with it a presumption of having taken place. And section 15 says, no adoption which has been validly made can be cancelled by the adoptive father or mother or any other person, nor can the adopted child renounce his or her status and as such return to the family of his or her birth. And the adoptive child acquires all the rights as of a natural born child in the adopted family and severs his rights from the natural family of whatever he had. Now the question which comes is, what if the adoption, the ceremony of adoption is not proved or it does not find support? Now, in such a situation, if the adoption does not have the ceremony proved, then in such a situation, the Supreme Court judgment, which is pivotal in this, is the judgment in Devi Prasad versus Tribeni Devi, 1970 Supreme Court, 1286. Now, this is the basic judgment which has been followed in 2006 Supreme Court and M. Gurudas, and later on in 2020 also. So basically, what does Devi Prasad say? It says, although no particular form is prescribed for the ceremony, the law requires that the natural parent should hand over the adoptive boy and the adoptive parent must receive him. The nature of the ceremony varying according to circumstances. Then it says in the course of the judgment, Subha Rao, as he then was, quotes main, quotes Sarkar from Hindu law to say, the ceremonies of giving and taking are absolutely necessary in all cases. These ceremonies must be accompanied by the actual delivery of the child, symbolical or constructive delivery by the mere parallel expression of intention on the part of the giver and the taker, without the presence of the boy is not sufficient. Nor are deeds of gift and acceptance executed and registered in anticipation of their intended adoption, nor acknowledgement sufficient by themselves to constitute legal adoption in the absence of actual gift and acceptance or accompanied by actual delivery, a formal ceremony being essential for that purposes. So then 2006 Supreme Court says, to prove a valid adoption, it would be necessary to bring on record that there has been an actual giving and taking ceremony. Performance of Datta Homan was imperative, subject to such exceptions. Above all, such a question would be permissible in law if agitated. Then Mullah is quoted. So this is a very important factor. And if the ceremony of adoption is not established, then in such a situation, the courts have ruled repeatedly that this is not going to lead to a valid adoption in these circumstances. Now, in 2020, Supreme Court 1293, in M. Vanaja versus Sarla Devi, this principle has been reiterated to urge and establish that if the ceremony of giving and taking has not taken place, then no adoption. It says the mandate of the Act of 56 is that no adoption shall be made unless there has been compliance with the condition mentioned in Chapter 1. The two essential conditions are consent of the wife and the actual ceremony having been established by the court. Now, I just reconnect this with a matter recently decided by the High Court in Richa Gupta versus the state, in which I was an amicus. Now, this was a very interesting case. There was a habeas corpus petition by a natural mother seeking the return of her child, whom she said had been illegally adopted. Now, it was a very interesting scenario. The lady's husband had died, so her in-laws were pressurizing her to hand over her child in adoption to a US-based couple of Hindu religion. Now, she was relenting and was not agreeable to the adoption. Now, on a particular date, when the adoptive parents could not come from USA, in the hometown, in the state of Punjab, the adoption deed was purportedly got signed from her when she had the child with her. But the parents who had to take an adoption were physically not present. So she says that her signatures were obtained on an adoption deed. The sister of the adoptive mother was there who took the child. Now, subsequently, when the adoptive couple came from the US on a later date, the child having already been taken away from her on the previous date, when they came, she did not go to the place in the city of Punjab where the adoption deed was signed by them, notarized and got registered. So on the first date, the adoptive parents were not present. And on the second date, the mother giving an adoption was not present. The question before the writ court was, in a habeas corpus, is this a valid adoption? Now, the other, since I was a neutral person, I cited this law and I told the honorable bench, I said, regardless of whatever they may say, because there is no giving and taking, simultaneously on the same date, the ceremony having not been performed, this adoption has to fall through. There is no valid adoption because of what the Supreme Court says. So this is the rigidity. This is the absolute necessity which the provisions of Hamma reflect in themselves by laying down the procedure for adoption as far as the Hamma is concerned. Now, let us switch to what the JJ Act has to say. Now, as I told you, the JJ Act of 2015 has undergone a massive transformation from what it used to be in 1986 and 2000. Now, Section 1, Subsection 4 of the JJ Act says that the provisions of the JJ Act shall apply to all matters concerning children in need of care and protection and in conflict with law, inter alia on procedures and decisions or orders regarding rehabilitation, adoption, reintegration and restoration of children in need of care and protection. Now, Section 213 defines children in conflict with law. 214 defines children in need of care and protection. 21 defines abandoned child. 242 orphan child. 260 surrendered child. 222 defines adoptions. 234 JJ Act defines inter-country adoptions. 23 defines adoption regulations. 27 defines authority. 27 defines best interests of child. Now, the best interests of the child, the definition given in the JJ Act, which I will read very quickly, is something which is not contained in any law. And I have started relying on this definition of best interest of the child, even in matters of inter-country parental child removal, by agitating that children in need of care and protection are also children removed forcibly. Therefore, this is a composite definition, which is for the benefit of the child, which has been brought per se because India has signed the UNCRC, and all the rights of the child are therefore to be implemented considering the gravity of the rights of the child. So very quickly, what is the definition of best interest of the child? It means the basis for any decision taken regarding the child to ensure fulfillment of his basic rights and needs, identity and social well-being, and physical, emotional, and intellectual development. It's a very wholesome definition. And I think it is a very good mix of all the provisions which UNCRC uses, and it has been very well brought in to give it a statutory mandate and for courts to follow. And I really wish and aspire that this definition ought to be used by family courts and guardian judges in coming to a conclusion in holding in favor of adoptions whenever needed. So 211 defines the central authority, 223 defines court, 252 defines relatives. Now, Section 56 says that the children who are covered in intercountry, all children covered for adoption are: one, orphan, abandoned and surrendered children, adoption of children from one relative by another relative. Now, this may be within the country or it may be cross-country. Then all inter-country adoptions from India have to perforce go through the JJ Act. Now, the crunch is what 56.3 says, that nothing shall apply to adoptions made under HAMA. We'll come to this in a little while. Now, 57 talks of eligibility of prospective adoptive parents. 58 talks of procedures for adoption of Indian prospective parents. 59 talks of inter-country adoption. 60 prescribes for inter-country relative adoptions. 61 is the procedure and penalty for wrong adoption. 62, procedures and documentation. 63, effective adoptions. Then 80 prescribes punitive measures for adoptions. Now, the adoption regulations, which have been framed under 68C of the JJ Act by the central government, have been notified. And these regulations are actually the crunch, which contain a very detailed procedure. Now, Regulation 3 prescribes the fundamental provisions regarding adoptions. 4 prescribes the child eligible for adoptions. 5, criteria for eligibility of prospective adoptive parents. 12 prescribes legal procedure for adoptions. 51 for inter-country adoptions. 53 for inter-country relative adoptions. 55 for legal procedure for all adoptions. 56 talks of NOC for all inter-country adoptions. And 60 prescribes for power of relaxation and interpretation. Now, rundown on these salient features of the UNCRC. Now, under Article 6 of the UNCRC, every child has an inherent right to life. Article 7, right to a name, nationality, and parentage. Article 8, right to identity, name, family relations, and nationality. 9, not to be separated from parents. 10, right of child and parents to reunification. Then 18, rights of child for upbringing by both parents. 20, child right of child to family environment. 21, best interest of the child. Then what are the salient features of the adoption convention? Article 2 talks of the application of convention to contracting states. Article 4 talks of the requirements of inter-country adoptions. 5 talks of suitability of adoptive parents, suitability. Article 6 talks of designation of a central authority in a contracting state. Article 14 talks of procedure application in a contracting state. 15 talks of satisfaction of eligibility parents. 16 further talks of eligibility. 17 talks of suitability of prospective adoptive parents. 18 talks of steps of the child to leave the state of origin. 19 talks of satisfaction of receiving state. 20 talks of central authorities keeping and being informed of the adoption process. 21 talks of the measures of central authorities. 23 talks of recognition and effects of adoption. 28 talks of exemption of domestic law. 37 talks of application of different legal systems in regard to adoptions. So broadly, the JJ Act and the adoption regulations in principle are in respect of children in conflict with law and need of care and protection, and also besides often abandoned and surrendered children, children who are of biological parents. Now, very quickly, reading down what Shabnam Hashmi says. Shabnam Hashmi, 2014, 4 SCC 1. The JJ Act as amended is an enabling legislation that gives a prospective parent the option of adopting an eligible child by following the prescribed procedure by the JJ Act, rules and CARA guidelines as notified under the Act. The Act does not mandate any compulsive action by any prospective parent, leaving such person with liberty of accessing the provisions of the Act if he so desires. Such a person is always free to adopt or choose not to do so, and instead follow what he comprehends to be the dictates of the personal law applicable to him. Now, I remember relying on this provision when I was put a question by the Supreme Court. I was arguing the matter of Aman Lohia in 2021. Now, Aman Lohia's case was a case where the father had removed the child from the custody of the mother on a visitation, violating the orders of the court by taking the child to Dubai via Nepal and thereafter going to Dubai and becoming a Muslim by religion until he was asked by the Supreme Court to come back with the team of the CBI. So ultimately, the Supreme Court had transferred an appeal to the guardianship petition before itself. So the question which was put to me was, you are no longer a Hindu. So in these circumstances, you cease to be a guardian to the child and you cannot even adopt the child. So my answer to this question was that be it the Guardian and Wards Act or be it the JJ Act, they are both secular laws. Now, unlike the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act, which is applicable only to Hindus, if I had preferred a petition under the HMGA, which I cannot because the procedure to go in for a guardianship is under the GWA, as we have seen in our previous sessions. Likewise, under the process of adoption, I have a route through the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act, but I have a route through the JJ Act also. So it is there that I drew a classification that these are secular laws, these are optional laws. I marry under the HMA, I marry under the SMA. I adopt under the HMGA, I adopt under the JJ Act. I become a guardianship under HMGA or under HAMA, or I adopt under the JJ Act. So this is the sequence of law which so emerges in these conditions. Now, broadly, without going into the nitty-gritties of procedure, how does the convention work? How does the inter-country or intra-country adoption work under the JJ Act? Now, first of all, the convention requires that whichever country signs the convention has to perforce create a law and a system according to the convention to liaise with other countries for inter-country adoptions. So you have to establish what is called a central authority, and the government of India has established CARA, Central Adoption Resource Authority. So from agency, it became authority. So CARA is the central authority under the JJ Act, which is supposed to liaise with the central authorities of countries worldwide when an inter-country adoption is to take place. So there is a system of registration under a surname called CARINS. It is Child Adoption Resource in Adoption Agencies process. So the abbreviation is CARINS. So under the CARINS system, be it India or be it abroad, you have to register wherever you are. If you are wanting to adopt a child from a country from where you are based. So if you are in the US, you will register under the system of that country. You will be evaluated and assessed by the agencies of that country, and they will prepare a report. In India, we call it a home study report. That report is then taken on board. If it is in a foreign country, it is taken on board, it is sent to the country from which you wish to make an adoption. Once it reaches India, if it is from a foreign country, they will match your requirement with a child as per your seniority. So they maintain a list and you will be admitted in the list. And as per your requirement of the age, the sex, and the availability, as per your seniority, you will be offered a child. You will be matched with the child. Once the assessment is done, you will be allowed to meet the child. In the case of an inter-country adoption, pre-foster NOC is granted by CARA. Then once everything goes on, then you have to get a court order to certify the adoption, and the court order looks that there is no exchange of money. Kara takes a fee officially, and once the court order is granted, then an NOC is granted by Kara. On the NOC being granted, you can approach the passport officer for a passport, and you can approach the embassy of the country from where you have come. They will grant you a visa and you can leave from it. Now, if it is a domestic adoption, you will register under Karens. A child will be matched after the agency where you are located. A specialized adoption agency will evaluate you, assess you, make a report, match you with the child. Once you match, you will go and get a court order, and the adoption formally takes place. For within the country, no NOC is required for Kara because there is no requirement of traveling abroad. Now, this is broadly how the things work. Now, the gray area is Section 56 of the JJ Act 2015. Now, I'm going to read the whole of it because this is a subject of discussion and debate which has come up in a number of judgments. So, 56 of the JJ Act 2015 says, all adoptions shall be resorted to for ensuring right to a family for the orphan, abandoned and surrendered children as per the provisions of this Act, the rules made thereunder, and the adoption regulations framed by the authority. 56.2. Adoption of a child from a relative by another relative, irrespective of their religion, can be made as per the provisions of this Act and the adoption regulations framed by the authority. So I repeat, adoption of a child from a relative by another relative, irrespective of their religion. So whether it is Muslims, whether it is Christians, whether it is Hindus, whether it is Parsis. Somebody asked me a question, if a Parsi child is adopted or a non-Parsi child is adopted by a Parsi, will the child be allowed to enter the temple? Will the child be allowed to live within a Parsi community which allows only Parsis? I said the adoption can be allowed. Now, whether the child will be allowed to enter the Parsi temple or whether the child will be allowed to live in the compound where only Parsis live is a separate matter which the court can go into or it can be looked at separately, but there is no bar on adoption. Then 56.3 says, now 56.3 is the bone of contention area. 56.3 says nothing in this Act shall apply to the adoption of children made under the provisions of HAMA. Looks very good. So, simply speaking, HAMA is a code in itself. And I read through HAMA, I read through JJ Act to show to you that there are two parallel systems of adoption under these two separate legislations, which are optional. Does one override the other? Does one have an inter-se difference or clash with the other? Which overrides whom? So a reading of 56.3 per se on the face of it, prima facie, gives an impression that the HAMA is a code in itself, a law unto itself, a procedure unto itself, and therefore HAMA stands out. Now, principally, there is a lot of difference. In HAMA, all you do is a ceremony of giving and taking. No writing, no execution, no notarization, no registration. Look at JJ Act to the contrary. Be it relative, be it non-relative, be it orphan, abandoned, surrendered. Evaluation, home study, checking, testing, court order, NOC. So obviously there is a lot much more in rigor of procedure. But then the question, the gray area becomes, the chasm comes when you read 56.4. All inter-country adoptions shall be done as per the provisions of this Act and adoption regulations framed by the authority. Now, this has become problematic. So, all inter-country adoptions shall be done as per provisions of this Act and the adoption regulations framed by the authority. Now, does this mean that all inter-country adoptions under Hamas shall also be done accordingly. Now, I say so because the words used are not. Now, if it was to say all adoptions, inter-country adoptions done under this act shall be as per the provisions of this act and the adoption regulations framed by the authority. Now, we presume that the word under this act is in it. We read it into it. So, all inter-country adoptions. Now, let us suppose there is an inter-country adoption under Hama. If, as the matter in which I was assisting, the ASG, arguing on behalf of Union of India, took a very hard stand and he said, whether it is an inter-country adoption under Hama, whether it is an inter-country adoption under JJ Act, you have to follow the procedure of a adoption, inter-country adoption of the JJ Act because of the mandate of 56.4. Now let us read 56.5. Any person who sends or takes a child to a foreign country or takes part in any arrangement for transferring the care and custody of the child to another person in a foreign country without a valid order from the court shall be punishable as per the provisions of subsection 1 of section 18. Now, 81 prescribes punishment. So the problem is now compounded. The catch 22 is bigger. Because it says if you are taking any child to a foreign country or you are having any arrangement for transferring the child to another person in a foreign country, a valid court order is necessary. And if you do not do so, there is punishment. Now, Hama does not prescribe any court order. Hama says, do your Hindu ceremony, do giving and taking, and Supreme Court says, giving and taking done, okay, everything is good. So the question is, does 56.3 water down before 56.4 and 5, or do 56.4 and 5 not apply to 56.3? Is the question which I put to myself, and I the way I handled it in two amicus instances is, I told the court, I said, if there is an adoption under Hama, it is irreversible. Under Hama, once you do the giving and taking, that's it. So if I don't go to the court to get a court order, nothing is wrong. I don't have to get a court order. But then how will I get an NOC from Kara? Kara says, we will not give you an NOC. Go get a court order. Under the passport manual, even the passport officer declines to issue you a passport. The passport officer says, I have a manual. Under this manual, I have a checklist. In the checklist is a Kara NOC. Now, the question has arisen in the Punjab and Haryana High Court in 3 or 4 cases. And a full bench of our High Court has held very categorically that there are 13 grounds in the Passports Act under which a passport can be declined. And the passport officer is nobody to look into the validity of an adoption. Then there are division benches which go to say that Kara's NOC cannot be insisted upon by a passport officer. Because once there is a valid adoption, and there is an adoption deed produced under section 16 of Hama, there is a presumption that a valid adoption has taken place unless it is disputed or it is rebutted. So therefore, a NOC from Kara is not a prerequisite or a compulsion necessarily required to be put across before a child under Hama can be taken abroad. I give you an instance, which was the case before the court in which I was in Amicus. There were two sisters, both Sikh religion, both married. One had two children, one had no children. The one living in England, who had acquired a British nationality with her husband, took an adoption. The child, newborn child of the other sister, the third child, through a process of giving and taking, it was recorded in a deed. It was registered also. But when they went to the passport officer, he says, I'm not even giving you a passport. So they came to the High Court saying that this condition is unreasonable. Now the High Court ruled that the passport officer cannot insist on a NOC from Kara. But the question did come up before the court. Does an NOC from Kara become an essential requirement? I told the court very candidly, yes, it has become an essential requirement for the simple reason that without an NOC from the Kara, the child will not be able to get a visa and the child will not be able to leave India. So we started reading the Adoption Convention. Now, in the Adoption Convention, I read to the court Article 23 and Article 28. I said these are adoptions, domestic adoptions, which are exempted, which are saved. How do this get saved? 23 reads, an adoption certified by the competent authority of the state of the adoption as having been made in accordance with the convention shall be recognized by operation of law in the other contracting states. So 23 is recognition and 28 is exemption. 28 says the convention does not affect any law of a state of origin which requires that the adoption of a child habitually resides within the state, within that state, take place in that state, or which prohibits the child's placement in the transfer to the receiving state prior to adoption. So I submitted to the court that in a domestic adoption under HAMA, there is a requirement of an NOC, because without the NOC, the child will not be able to leave India and no visa will be granted by the embassy. But what is to be done? The parents adopting the child have to submit representation to Kara saying this is a domestic adoption under HAMA. The Kara can constitute a committee. They have the provision in the adoption regulations to check the veracity of the adoption. The Kara can test the antecedents of the parties through state agencies or the concerned authorities in the of the state, the district magistrate or any other executive officer of the Women and Child Development Department, have a report submitted. And thereafter, Kara can issue what is called a conformity certificate. What will the conformity certificate say? It will say that the requirements of the convention have been met with and the child has been duly adopted as per the domestic law, which is saved by the provisions. So this, in my view, was the way out. And this is what I suggested to the court. The matter has gone to a division bench. It has still not been settled. So this is what the limbo is. Now, before all this had happened, there was a judgment of the Supreme Court in Anokha. Now, in Anokha 2004, 1 SCC 382, it had been said that a child given an adoption by its biological parents to a foreign couple need not follow the guidelines prescribed for adoption of Indian children. Now, this was a case where a taxi driver's child had been taken in adoption by a foreign couple. The mother had given an adoption after the taxi driver died and the family had taken fondness to the child. So the Supreme Court said, this is permitted. But at the same time, in St. Teresa's Loving Care Home and others, in 2005, 8 SCC 525, Supreme Court did say that the need to prevent trafficking of children and promoting welfare should be adhered to by following the guidelines in Lakshmikant Pandey. Now, Lakshmikant Pandey, I had already referred to you, but then the question came of the question of clash came in 2019 1 KLT 57. This is Jeshi's case, 2019 1 KLT 57. Now, the High Court of Kerala said that the guidelines laid down under the JJ Act would prevail, and any personal law on that subject and that age limit prescribed in the guidelines is not discriminatory. Now, the question raised in this case was that the children were not possibly allowed to be adopted because under the JJ Act, there is a limit that if the child is this old, the age of the parent should not be more than this. Now, the logic is that there is a lot of energy in a small child, so parents have to be young. Now, the person had contended that there is no such age limit in the HAMA. Now, the court said no. The requirements of HAMA and JJ Act are separate. Now, the another very contested case was Sivarama's case. Now, this is again a division bench judgment of the Kerala High Court, 2021 KLT 294. Now, in this case, the child had been adopted under the provisions of HAMA, and the CWC, in a very invigorative role, picked up the child and brought the child into its custody, saying the provisions of JJ Act had not been complied with. So the High Court ruled that the child has to go back. I think the observations here of the Kerala High Court are important to read. I will just go through it quickly. And here the High Court said that there is no necessity of the child being, child have to go through the procedure of this. I'll just find that judgment. Now there is another very interesting judgment of the Bombay High Court. This is in re-adoption of Payal. This is an unreported judgment. It's a reported judgment. It is 2010-1 Bombay CR 434. Now this is a case by a very beautiful judgment by Justice Chandrachud. Now this is a case where there was a couple adopting a female child. They had another female child already, and the issue raised was whether a Hindu couple governed by HAMA with a child of their own can adopt a child of the same gender under the provisions of the JJ Act. Now, the Supreme Court, the Bombay High Court, then, as his lordship then was as a judge of the Bombay High Court, he said that JJ Act is a secular law, and JJ Act does not prohibit a person adopting another child of the same sex if there is a child already of the same gender, because there is no such prohibition contained in this law of not being allowed to adopt a child of the same religion. So the JJ Act, therefore, was made to stand out in this situation. Now, the two judgments of the Delhi High Court, which say that NOC of Kara is not necessary in domestic adoptions, are PKH versus Kara. This is not reported, but this is writ petition 5718 of 2015, decided on 18th of July 2016. Then the second judgment is again of the Delhi High Court, Divyan Charoda versus Union of India. Now this was in this case, the child was to be taken to Germany by the parents, and Kara refused to grant an NOC. Now it was an adoption between the same family members. The relations had been permitted, and the child had been taken in adoption. So the Delhi High Court said it is a very precarious situation. The child has severed all his ties, and if the child is now not allowed to go, it will create a very anomalous situation. So this is 2017. 166 DRJ 628 Delhi. So this is the judgment of these are two judgments of the Delhi High Court on this perspective. So this is one part of the story, and very quickly. Now, there is a little bit in the provisions of the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act on the definition of the word guardian. And there is in the Guardian and Wards Act also a little infraction on that point. So in Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act, the word guardian has been defined to mean a person having the care of a person of a minor or his property, and includes a natural guardian, a guardian appointed by the will of the minor, of the minor's father or mother, and a guardian appointed or declared by the court. And the similar definition of the word guardian is in the Guardian and Wards Act, meaning a person having care of the person of a minor or of his property or both. Now, the definition of the word guardian has assumed a lot of significance in the context today because of the children who are vulnerable, of whose parents have died, and who are, so to say, in the hands of caretakers. So what is their status is a debatable point. So it is with this backdrop that I leave the floor open to questions, opinions, views, and doubts, because in my handling of these issues over the past 6 months, I find that there is quite a diverse opinion. And the question to be resolved is, if we are going to do adoptions under HAMA, what is going to be the role of CARA? What is going to be the role of the JJ Act? Whether inter-country adoptions need to follow the procedure under the JJ Act, or a conformity certificate will serve the purpose? So, Prem Raj,
over. Yes, yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for that wonderful articulation. And before we go to Justice Ram Kumar and Justice Ramakrishnan, may I just recognize the presence of Justice M.R. Anita of the Kerala High Court.
Yes, welcome.
As Advocate Anil Malhotra, he has taken us to the nuances of adoption. We know that adoption, this is the legal process of giving and taking of a child to the non-biological parent. And we can see that this concept is traceable in our country from time immemorial. If we see Article 1 of our Constitution, that opens with the words India, that is Bharat. And the name Bharat is one attributable to the legendary emperor Bharata, who is the ancestor of Pandavas and Kauravas. And we see instances of adoption in the great epics Mahabharata and Ramayana. Emperor Bharata's mother, Shakuntala, she was born to sage Vishwamitra in Menaka, and she was adopted by Rishi Kanwa. Satyavati, the stepmother of Bhishma, she was the adoptive daughter of a fisherman by name Dasharaj. Even Bhishma's father, King Shantanu, he was the adoptive father of the abandoned twins Kripa and Kripi. Then you see, charioteer Atirath was the adoptive father of the great Karna, whom he found in a basket afloat on the river. Kunti herself was an adopted daughter. But not unlike Karna, she was born as princess by name Prita to King Surasena, who was a Yadava king. And she was given to her own childless uncle, King Kuntibhoj. And she had to change her name as Kunti. Lord Krishna, even though he was born to the princess Devaki of Madura, he was brought up by his foster mother, Yashoda at Gokul. And Sita Ramayana, the central character Sita, she is the adopted daughter of King Janaka and his wife Sunina. And King Dasharath, apart from four sons, had a daughter by name Shanta, who was born in his queen Kausalya, who was later given in adoption to the childless King Romapada and his wife Varshini, who was none other than the Queen Kausalya's sister. So this is what you can trace from the history of India, from the great epics. Now, first, let me go to Justice Ram Kumar for his comments. Over to you, sir.
Excellent presentation, sir. In fact, I am delighted find that Prem Raj is an authority on Mahabharata as well. Ready reckoner on Mahabharata as well.
You should call him Pandit Prem Raj.
Now, sir, I have one doubt. Yes. Supposing there is a domestic adoption under AMA.
Yes, sir.
But just to enable the adopted child to go abroad.
Yes, sir.
Can they not undergo another adoption under JJ Act so that they can get a CARA clearance?
Sir, there will be a major issue. Why? Because the JJ Act will require you to register under carings. They will say you follow the procedure, wait for your seniority. Whether you will get that child or not, again, will be a discretion of CARA. You have to go through the whole process. And sir, let us pause here for a minute.
Yes.
If we are going to do so, we are jeopardizing and questioning the adoption under HAMA, which is irreversible.
Irreversible, yes. You're right.
Therefore, once, it is just like saying, I have got married under Hindu Marriage Act. Now, let me marry under Special Marriage Act also, like our friend Sham has done. So... or I have to do a Catholic ceremony also.
Anything which is said in his absence is liable to be expunged.
He's not there, so we can take the liberty of doing all this. So I'm only using an illustration. So yes. Illustrations are to be quoted without names henceforth. So what I'm saying, sir, we cannot do away with our personal law simply because there is a secular law which has a parallel provision. And sir, if we have to read 56, see, the bottom line is, how do we read 56.3? Do we water it down with 56.4 or 5, or what do we do? I think the Supreme Court has to decide this question ultimately, sooner or later.
Yes.
So sir, I don't think we should do it. I have been representing to CARA often on behalf of parents. See, sir, let us understand. When the natural parents are alive, they are performing the duties of CARA. They are conscious of what they are doing. They are taking care of what they are doing. And they are handing over their child in the child's best interest to a person whom they know or whom they are associated with.
Yes.
So you obviate the role of CARA in that process. Now, and once the UNCRC allows and recognizes domestic adoptions, so all CARA has to do is put on its spectacles and the lens, screen it, and give a conformity certificate. Because, sir, if we go through the drill again, one, we are questioning the validity of adoption under HAMA, we are nullifying the procedure under HAMA, and we are going through a process which is wholly unnecessary.
Well said, well said. Because and there's no guarantee that the same child will be given in adoption. That is the real problem.
Because that is the procedure of CARA. They will match your child. Suppose you are the child which you are opting for is matched with somebody else who is higher in seniority. You can't do that. And they say, I'm sorry, you have submitted to this process. Now we can't change it.
Okay.
And sir, then what is the gray area? What will happen to the adoption under HAMA? Will it become zero? It can't.
Then how do you reconcile between 56.3 and a HAMA domestic adoption after the commencement of JJ Act?
Sir, I say the parliament in its wisdom specifically left adoptions under HAMA alone. If we read 56, they consciously put it there, sir. Either it shouldn't have been there. See, let us read 56.3 again.
Yes.
Nothing in this act shall apply to the adoption of children made under HAMA. Or bottom line. Sir, they could have said, nothing in this act shall apply to adoption of children within India made under HAMA. There is no rider, there is no restriction, there is no proviso. The right is... The charter is unlimited. The right is unencompassed. The mandate is open to sky. The mandate is not hedged, restricted, or covered. It says nothing in this act shall apply to adoption of children made under Hama. So this means adoption of children within country or outside country made under Hama are not to be governed by Hama. So the question is, which the judges put to me in two cases, is then why NOC? So I said the NOC is a requirement of the convention. And under the convention, there is a provision of a conformity certificate or an exemption. Kara can grant an exemption certificate. Kara can grant a conformity certificate. Because
but are they granting it? Are they granting it?
I have got a specimen. I can read it out to you.
Okay.
See, in the judgment, let me read out to you Jasmine Kaur's judgment, which is reported as 2023 RCR Civil 528, Jasmine Kaur versus Union of India. It is before a division bench, but regardless of what it is, so the
which court? Which court?
Punjab Haryana High Court.
Punjab
Haryana, Jasmine Kaur versus Union of India, Justice Nirmaljeet Kaur. I was an amicus here, and the ASG fought with me. The ASG said, my lord, the counsel is arguing as if he's the petitioner's counsel. So I told the judge, I recuse. If that is the allegation, I'm assisting the court. Then the court told the ASG, you are supposed to be assisting me, not pleading the case of Kara. Your job is to get the law settled, and you have to guide the court, not plead for the government of India. And sir, the conclusion ultimately was, thus it would be in the interest of the adoptive parents of the child in question to obtain a simple NOC from Kara in order to ensure a clean transition from one country to another, lest they face any difficulty for the purpose of visa or any other requirement. Accordingly, in view of the earlier discussion, holding that adoption is valid with no right either to Kara and JJ Act to question the same on account of the adoption under Hama, which was a direct adoption by the adoptive parents from the biological parents between close relatives, the detailed, tedious procedure prescribed under the JJ Act and Kara is not required. Therefore, Kara is simply required to issue a NOC in the same form to be issued to a child by the name of Sai Hamija, female, copy of which has been handed over by learned amicus and is taken on record as A1. Accordingly, it is held that the valid adoption under Hama of a minor child cannot be revoked unless disproved. It is not mandatory to invoke JJ Act in the facts and circumstances of the present case, where the adoption is a direct adoption by the parents of the known adoptive parents, relatives under Hama. So, sir, this answers your question. And if you're interested,
sir, why can't they revise the Kara norms so that in cases where there is a valid adoption under the Hama, these restrictions will not be insisted.
I'll tell you why. Because I have been doing this for 36 years. Kara, unfortunately, has grown so big and so possessed with its power that they are a law unto themselves now. Kara was headed by the then social welfare minister, Menaka Gandhi, who was very empowered. I remember, I may have shared this with you, attending a conference in National Judicial Academy, Bhopal, when Justice Raghu Ram was director. He called me up. He said, Justice Kher has demanded that Menaka Gandhi he can't handle because she says, your judges are very slow in deciding all my adoption cases. Look at the graph. They said, are we, then they might as well put a draft order also in the guidelines. So actually, sir, the adoption regulations have gone too far. You know, the secretary WCD and Kara is headed by a CEO, Chief Executive Officer, who was an ex-army officer, no judicial training. So they said, they probably started thinking that they are a court of adoption. I personally think that the CEO of the Kara should be a retired judge of the High Court. Otherwise, you can't do this.
Right.
I think, in my humble view, the adoption regulations have gone so far that they have whittled down the act itself. This is what has happened. This is in an overdrive. Now, as we see it already, the new women and child development minister has gone to parliament, and I think the law has been amended. Now a district magistrate will grant an NOC for an adoption. So what will happen? You will have all those agents hanging around outside the office. For 5,000 rupees, you will start getting an NOC like any license, permit or quota. So this mockery, I think, should end. The adoption should go back to the court, one, number one. And number two, I told the chairman of the NCPCR, I said, you should take it up with CARA. You are under the Commission of Protection of Child Rights Act. You have powers more than the Supreme Court. So in very fluent Hindi, he told me a lot of things. Half of them I couldn't understand. I said, how can you interfere? So, sir, what is happening now? Now, CARA is becoming so big, they don't even look at anything. They say, you go, you have to follow CARA. You have to follow the JJ Act. And as, sir, you were saying, they say, you start all over again. Then you might as well read down 56.3. I think Supreme Court will have to, in a given case, lay down conclusively. You see, these two, three judgments have come in 2020. The pandemic has halted the decision-making process. But, sir, what happens? Now, in the other case in which I was in amicus, the child is to be returned back because the adoption deed has been set aside. But the judge said, I differ with the single judge of in Jasmine Kaur's case. And insofar, he says, all inter-country adoptions, CARA NOC is necessary, JJ Act provision, the NOC is necessary from CARA. So I refer this question to larger bench. In Jasmine Kaur's case, matter was challenged. The matter went to Supreme Court. So Supreme Court has remanded it back to the High Court. So it is now before a division bench. It's not been heard because we have gone into sleep mode. So the question remains.
Sir, can there be intra-country adoption under HAMA?
Yes. Oh. Sir, HAMA. When HAMA was made in 1956, only Mahabharata and Ramayana scriptures, which Prem Raj has very, very eloquently mentioned, were in force. So they were in, people were in, after all, Hanuman did fly with Sanjeevani. So maybe some children are also flown across borders. There is Annie Besant's case in 1923. It's a reported case of the Privy Council, where children were taken to England from India. Well, it did happen. So, sir, my question is, when HAMA is a code in itself, and, sir, regardless of what the JJ Act says in 2015, it did in 56.3 say HAMA. So, in 2015, the thought process of Parliament was that the law of the Hindus made in 1956 should be saved. One. Two, HAMA, sir, relative inter-country adoptions are very popular in North India because there is a lot of, it must be in Kerala also. See, brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Close relatives. So what has happened? One brother, sister, extended family man lives in England, Canada, America, Australia. So he or she has no child. There is plenty full of children with another family member. So they say, all right, we will take your child. And sir, it is very common. You have an 8 or 10 year old child. People say this child will have a better future. There, you have three children. This one child I will take abroad. He will be very good for the family. So they take the child abroad. So, sir, till these 2017 adoption regulations came, CARA was granting an NOC. The problem has come because of the 2017 regulations, which are very rigid. So, actually speaking, in Anokha's case, Justice Rooma Pal did a wonderful job saying, no, need nothing doing. But Anokha's judgment is no longer accepted by CARA. CARA says, no. Bring them in. We will look into this. So in when this case was, Jasmine Kaur's case was decided on 28th of July 2020, I told the bench, I said, here is an NOC in a domestic adoption in Hyderabad between relatives. This is the adoption deed. This is the conformity certificate. So this is the way out. You have to actually read down from the JJ Act. You have to get into the convention. See where is the NOC requirement. It is in the convention. You can take it into the JJ Act or you can keep it in the convention. But there is a way of handling it. So actually speaking, if you read, if you apply a judicious mind and you read the act, what Kara has to do is Kara has to examine the adoption, look at in the details of the adoption. Obviously, they can't question the adoption. They have to see whether it is a child of the relative of the family, how old is the child, whether the basic requirements of Hama are satisfied. And once Hama, Hama is a law unto itself. Who can be adopted? Who will adopt? That's why I read everything.
Right.
All the requirements are in parallel in both the laws. So once you have a law making a requirement and you satisfy the law, you can't say, no. Now you follow the JJ Act also. And that is not the intention of law. Then why did you put 56.3?
So naturally, JJ Act should have those restrictions. Kara restrictions should apply only to an adoption undergone under the JJ Act, is it not?
Absolutely. Now you got it, sir. So if you suppose you are doing an intercountry adoption under JJ Act, then you have to follow the drill. But sir, then in JJ Act, you will not get the child whom you want.
Correct.
A relative's child. That relative's child will also have to be put in into the system, and you will have to come as per the list.
Hama will apply only to Hindus. What about non-Hindus?
Hama will not, sir. No, obviously no. Non-Hindus, Hama will not apply. So if you are a Christian, you are a Muslim, you are a Parsi or a Jew, you have to come under the JJ Act. No choice.
JJ. Correct.
This is so, sir. Let us look at it in another way. This is also a political mandate of the government to keep the law of Hindus intact. Nobody wants to touch the Hindus. Let's look at an example, age of marriage. In any other law, it will be void. But in Hindus, they don't touch anybody. It's neither invalid, it is neither void, nor it is voidable.
Factum valid, yes.
So, sir, I think it is more of a political question also, and nobody will touch it.
Yes.
Now, current, sir.
Shall I ask one more question?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Now, under Hama, the adoption has to be given by both father and mother, did not?
If one is missing, then obviously...
Supposing the father is living... both are living apart, and father is not consenting party, but mother wants to give in adoption. Is there any way out?
Court order, sir.
Court order only.
Court order, then court order. Then you go to the court and say it's in the welfare of the child. Get over it, sir. You see, suppose the father is non-participating. Now let us see a case like ABC. Mother gets a certificate, birth certificate without the name of the father. She can give the child an adoption without the permission of the father because he's the natural guardian of a Hindu shall be the father and after him the mother. Father means absentee father, Gita Harihara. So you can actually read down. I think all you need is a smart lawyer like Prem Raj.
Then is there a doctrine of relating back in adoption?
I don't think so, sir. You can go behind the date. It severs from the date of adoption. It can't be retrospective. It can't be say when ever since we got married.
That was one question which I was asked by Chief Justice Maliman when I appeared for the district judge's interview way back in 1987. You know, five judges, I appeared before an interview panel of five judges. Chief Justice Maliman asked me, of course, I could answer almost all questions. But one question which really puzzled me was this doctrine of relating back. I said it is a doctrine available in when a document is executed and is subsequently registered. The registration will relate back to the date of execution. Is that wrong?
This question is so simple, Prem Raj can answer it.
Before that, sir, let me ask you one thing.
Yes.
Personal law for Christians, does it recognize the concept of adoption?
I think it does. It does.
I think there are decisions.
There are decisions.
Justice Lashmikutty said that there is no bar.
There is no bar. In the absence of any prohibition, can be.
And they can go only under the guardian and wards act to get guardian appointed, not as adoption as such.
But sir, there must be some Catholic procedure. There must be some religious procedure of like you do baptism.
Giving and taking.
There must be some religious procedure. After all, I mean, Christianity has been in vogue for centuries, and since this is something which has been going on ever since time immemorial, there must be something, because it was a practice. It was definitely a practice. It may be an informal process like the Hindus. See, what is amazing is that no writing, no recording, no registration. And it is good till JJ Act 2015. So keeping it untouched, the mandate of the lawmaker is very clear.
Even simpler than a will. Will at least requires a writing.
No, sir. Will can be oral.
Oral?
Oral, yes. Succession Act, okay. Sir. Will can be oral.
Okay.
If you write it, then you have two witnesses. But will can be oral. Though proving it will be very difficult.
So similar to a will, is it not?
Sir, in will, you have a complication. I handled in a trial. If the will is signed, then you have to, the testator has to sign in presence of the witnesses. And yes, the witnesses have to sign in the presence of the testator. So, yes. And when the will is to be proved, if there is a probate, then you have to produce a testing witness, or the testator is gone. Beneficiary can't step in. So if your two witnesses are not there, then you are in trouble. Now, I encountered this in a non-resident Indian matter.
But the section itself says both the attestors need not be simultaneously present.
Fair enough.
But is it not? But sir, the decisions are to the effect that, sir, one attestor will have to prove the attestation by the other also. Okay, how is it possible if both of them were not simultaneously present?
You see, sir, it is like this. They have both to sign in the presence of the testator. Now,
ordinarily.
But if one sign, suppose you cannot produce either of them when the will is probated. Now, I was in England.
That is for proving it, is it not?
Probate, sir, probate.
For proof
of will. So I had gone to England to write the will of a non-resident Indian in respect of Indian properties. So there were two witnesses. Now in England, the notary came in a very fancy car with all those ribbons. So the family also recorded the whole thing. The beneficiaries were not to be present, but they were present. So I was also there because I had drafted the will and I was the executor of the will. So I saw the testator sign, I saw the witnesses sign. When the question came of a probate, I had instructed a counsel in Delhi to handle it. But the judge said, I am not going to grant you probate till you produce a testing witness. Now, one of them had got AIDS and the other one had got dementia. So, sir, I stepped in as a witness and I produced a CD with 65B affidavit saying I was present, I saw the testator sign, and I saw the witnesses sign. And that is how we got the will out. Because then I stepped in as observer, and there were judgments of the Delhi High Court.
Which said, scribe proving execution.
So the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So, sir, all the interesting questions, juicy questions you have taken. Mr. Ravan is waiting still yet to pounce on me with his.
Sir, because even though you had answered that the Christian law, because what Justice Ramakrishnan would say, that it is only through the Guardian and Wards Act of 1890 that can be made applicable to the Christians. Because there should be some formality. Right.
Give and take.
And actually, there's a decision by Justice Ram Kumar, Biju Ramesh's case, 2000. Says that Christians, they recognize this adoption. And regarding the other question,
see my memory.
Is whether adoption can relate back. See, right now, sir, Vinita Sharma, that is 2029 SEC page 1, Justice Arun Mishra speaking for a three judge bench, which considered a coparsoner heir's right by birth under Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act of 56. And he goes on to hold that another method is to be a coparsoner is by way of adoption. Oh. So it has to naturally relate back. Three judgments. Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma, 2025.
Probably this was what the Justice Chief Justice Malimut had in mind.
But sir, let me fill you in. Before all this rigmarole of the NOC came in, all inter-country adoptions by all kinds of persons, whether Christians, Hindus or whatever, everybody had to file. There was no provision. So everybody invoked the Guardian and Wards Act. And after adopting the child, they got a guardianship certificate from the court. And only if there was a guardianship certificate under the Guardian and Wards Act granted by the guardian judge, that the embassy gave a visa. So the exit route earlier, prior to the NOC, was the Guardian and Wards Act.
Okay. Now we would go to Justice Ramakrishnan for his comments.
No, really, it's a, what do you call, whenever Anil Malhotra comes, more than an answer, question will be there for resolving it. And it may be sometimes deeper, you will have to go into deeper and also to find out solution as to how these problems can be. As regards the pandemic issues are concerned, if I remember correct, there is some petition cases pending before the Supreme Court asking for this central government to frame some rules, etc., as to how such children cannot be dealt with instead of leaving them on streets. Something like that. If I remember correct, I do not know, because I have seen only in the newspapers. I do not know whether any matter is pending like that or any so motor case has been taken on that, as because I think that in Delhi, some issue has been raised in respect of that, and Delhi High Court has directed the JJ people are to take, if nobody is there to look after it. If I remember correct, some directions have been given. As you have rightly said, yeah, the Hindu Adoption Maintenance Act applies only to Hindus and also to relatives.
Hmm.
Because a non-relative cannot take this thing. So people may be knowing about it. They are the best person to decide which is the welfare of the, what is the welfare of the child. And also, when it comes between the relatives, each will be knowing about each other, and it's a better relation is there. So they will take care of the child.
But what about a non-Hindu relative of a Hindu?
My version of marriage.
Marriage.
Sir must add fuel to the fire.
No, then see, either you allowed to adopt, you allowed to say that I am a Hindu or this thing.
You follow the Guardian and Wards Act procedure.
Then you allowed to go there and get a guardianship certificate and take it.
I think the alternative exit is GWA. A non Hindu relative can go under GWA. He can say, I don't want to go. See, you want that child. So you bypass, take a route, circuitous route. Take a bypass and follow GWA and adopt the child. Become a guardian to the child. Nobody can object to that.
Even the Supreme Court also only said in the case
will Kara give clearance?
Kara clearance is required if you have to take the child out of India.
Yes, yes. We want to take it out of India.
Well, sir, you know what you can do? You can apply, and if they don't grant it, file a writ in the High Court, get the matter decided.
Correct, because this has been declared to be a fundamental right in 2018.
Probably we will have to call Malhotra ji as an amicus.
No, sir, I will tell you why. See, there is a case by judgment by Justice Gogoi, Stephane Jones Becker. Now, this was a 63-year-old woman who had adopted a 9-year-old girl. The guardian judge declined the adoption. The Kara declined the adoption. High Court declined the adoption, saying that the age requirement is not fulfilled. The mother is too old to adopt. But Justice Gogoi allowed it. He says the bonding has taken place between the child. It is for the welfare of the child. The child will have a better future. The child will be more secure. We have examined it. We allow the adoption. So, sir, I think when a constitutional court comes in,
child will call her mother or grandma.
Whatever, sir, whatever. But, sir, the question is,
yes,
the future and the betterment of the child.
Well, so, not that. No, when surrogacy is permissible by a daughter, when the mother leasing out her womb for the purpose of getting the child of the daughter, I don't think nothing wrong in it.
Sir, it has happened. It is not. It is not old. It is not new. I mean, it has happened that the grandmother has given her womb up.
No, in Kerala also somewhere I read some
yes, it is possible. Yeah. It is possible. And this is what the government was proposing, only a close family relative should be the
surrogate mother,
etc. But then it is going to lead to a lot of confusion. Which lady within the family will agree? It sounds absurd. You have to leave it open. I was recently contacted by a man in Bangalore who said to me that he's looking for a child through surrogacy. He has two children already. And unfortunately, he was going on having a child of a particular sex, which I told him, I said, don't talk like this. We have to disconnect. Anyway, he opened up. Sir, surrogacy in Georgia, in Ukraine, and California is booming. They have, if you go on the website of this Ukraine agency, they have packages, diamond, super diamond, 5-star, full star, and 10,000 euros keeps on increasing. So they say either you come here and donate your egg and sperm, or we will give you an egg or a sperm if one component we need. We will give you a surrogate, or you can send it in a jar in the embryo, and you can come 15 days before the baby is to be born, and we will get you an Indian passport also. Ukraine has gone that far. California also, this is going on. So, sir, manufacturing is a process. We have started it, but we stopped it. Now, yes. Whether we let it go on or not, it is going to go on.
Only thing is, the child should not be sold for spare parts.
Absolutely. The organs, sir, removal of organs, yes.
Organ.
But, sir, let me tell you, surrogacy actually started as an offshoot by Indians, because adoption under JJ Act was very difficult and it was very long. People said, we can't wait. So they started going into surrogacy. And it became very popular. So it flourished from 2005 to 2012 till the government stopped it. And now still we are battling on a bill. We are in 2021. We still don't know what to do. So all these obstructions of Kara, some of them may be good. Surrogacy actually developed as an offshoot, because everybody said we can have our own genetic material instead of having an adopted child of some different genetic composition. So these are complex family laws, actually, which actually law has remained static. And society has gone very far.
Soon we may have cloned human beings.
Yes, sir, Bill, absolutely. You don't know whether these places in Ukraine may be doing designer babies. Well, you yes. want blonde hair, you want yes. black eyes. You want
Holstein cows are being produced through cloning.
Sir,
the other day I read I saw this thing. What's up? This thing. A live cell is removed from a healthy healthy cock, and chicken is being produced by cloning. And there is one hotel in Singapore which gives chicken items which manufactured by it through cloning.
Very popular abroad.
You have very, very healthy chicken.
Very, very big size chickens. They're all artificially produced by different means. We have a National Dairy Research Institute in Karnal in Haryana, where hybrid Jersey cows are created like this only. And they give a massive amount of milk. It's a very common process. And sir, three parent babies are also common in UK. So mitochondria of diseases are taken away. So if you have a life-threatening disease, those mitochondria are taken away. And mitochondria, which are good, which will not cause dementia, cerebral palsy or something, can be injected and healthy babies can be produced. But you may have a Frankenstein going the wrong way.
Correct.
Okay, now let us go to the question and answer session. Now we have Anaka Nambiar. Anaka, could you kindly unmute?
Yes, sir. My question is on the process of adoption after the divorce. How is it possible, or what is the maze and easiest way and convenient? Because this all comes into the child's difficulty, that if the mother is divorced and the child is in her custody, the non-custodian parent may or may not consent for adoption to the new husband of the mother. So in that case, how is that you would advise to go for this? Will again Kara come into picture into such type of adoptions?
See, if it is a domestic adoption, there is no role of Kara. Because there is no NOC required and there is nothing to be done in that situation. Now, it can be compared to a relative adoption because the I presume there is a, the lady has remarried, so there is a husband who is the husband of the lady. So he can adopt the child formally. It's quite common and quite popular that the husband who is not the father but is the stepfather. He can adopt the child. There is no difficulty on that. And the court, suppose the father is who the non-custodial natural father contests or opposes, it can be contested. And if the court is of the opinion that the welfare of the child demands that the child bond with the stepfather, you can have a ruling in your favor. There is no bar on the process of adoption taking place through this. And I think this kind of an adoption can take place. You will have to use the Guardian and Wards Act, actually speaking, because there is really no provision under
AMMA
for a court to go into this.
Sir, what in case of a widowed mother, in case she gets remarried, then how is she being the natural guardian, can she herself give the child in adoption to the husband?
Yes, she can. She can. Because there is a provision in the HMG itself. I had read it out. Now, if there is a, she is the natural guardian, and such as in such a situation, the provision is in the HMG itself. I will just point it out to you very quickly. Now, section 8, powers of a natural guardian. First of all, it says Guardian and Wards Act will apply for permission. Then court means the city civil court. And the provision regarding the persons capable of giving an adoption, section 9 of the HAMA. Where both the father and mother are dead or have completely renounced the world or have abandoned or have been declared unsound, the parentage of the child is not known, the guardian of the child may give the child in adoption. Now, in a situation where there is only one parent, you will be the natural guardian. Yeah. So no issue. If you want to give your child in adoption, you can give it as your guardian, but you will need the permission of the court in such a situation. If there is any issue of contest or something. That permission is under 9.5.
Sir, can this process by any ways made it simpler in a sense that, as you know, in a regular divorce cases where the child is in custody of the one parent, after despite the custody orders and after the remarriage of the spouse, again they have to go to the laws of, you know, city civil court, as you rightly said, for to have the process of adoption to the new husband or the stepfather or the stepmother. So can this process, is it possible to make it simpler in a sense because a new legal battle starts on after the divorce for the custody rather the adoption?
I understand. See, under section 6, the father and after him the mother is a natural guardian. So if you are able to establish that the father is non-participative and the mother is stepping into the shoes of the natural guardian, you have a right. But the question will be, the objection being raised at one stage or the other by the natural guardian whose rights he may want to bring back. So I guess the necessary evil is to buy your peace and get a court order to put an end to it. And a simple process of going to the city civil court by the stepfather, arraying the natural father as a respondent to the party and saying, if he doesn't contest, he's proceeded ex parte, you will get an order immediately. If he contests, what objection can he have? If the child says, I am happy with the stepfather, if the child says, I am happy with the mother, I am not going back to the stepfather who has already given me up, I think you will have a complete peace for future. And it will help you in documentation, the name and the change of name in the passport, the change in the name of school records, the name of change of name in future life. And inheritance rights, most of all.
Exactly.
So it is better to have clarity an affirmity in writing by a court order for future forever. I would think that is the best answer.
Sir, but this, as you said, right, as you rightly said, the child's opinion be considered, but this will be after only a particular age, if the child is minor of 5-6 years old or so.
The general opinion is, if the child is old enough to form an intelligible preference, the court will look at the child. Now, if the child is very small, then of course the child is not to form an opinion. But the court, if it finds it necessary, the court can seek an evaluation from a child psychologist. Or it can have it can take the child in chambers and have a word with the child. So there are ways and means in which you can go around it. But it may not be an absolute necessity. There is no requirement in law that the child has to be heard before an order has to be passed. It's a discretion which the court can exercise.
Okay, sir, now this is good to Dr. Hitesh. But...
Yeah. Hi, sir. I want to ask one question.
Yes.
Yeah, sir. The adoption under Hindu Adoption Act is between two Hindus, right? Not necessarily the relatives.
No, Hindu relatives also.
No, but it can be any two unknown Hindu families.
Absolutely, it can be.
And the second point is, sir, when the exchange of the child has happened, the process has happened, it has taken place, but it is still mandatory to make some document, because whenever the couple wants to get some certificate, say passport or visa, they require some kind of document. They can't show the pictures of the process or ceremony. Yes. So what kind of agreement you suggest? Because if you go for a registered document, the registrar says no to sign it or not to register it. They say you get the court order in Mumbai especially.
Okay. I'll tell you the way out. You see, let us try to first go into the time when the act was made. See, in 1956, when this act was made, people saw it and it was deemed to be registration. Hindu marriages are not registered because you go in a procession on a horseback. So that is registration. But times have changed. We need documents. So what do? We buy a stamp paper for 100 rupees. We write an adoption deed. You go to a deed writer. If you're a lawyer, you can write it yourself. You record in that. It's a very simple two-page thing. You write 20 paras. Say, this is so-and-so, this is so-and-so. He's giving, he's taking. We have performed the ceremonies of giving and taking, which has been witnessed on so-and-so date by so-and-so people. From this date, he will sever the rights. This date, he will sever the rights. And this ceremony has been concluded in the presence of so-and-so on this date and so-and-so. On the left side, adoptive parent sign. On the right side, parents taking adoption sign. Two witnesses witness it. Go to a notary, pay him a small fee, get it notarized. End of story.
Okay. But sir, some agencies, they insist on a registered document. And registrar refuses to sign. So I think notarized document should be good enough.
Absolutely. Notarized document is good enough. You go to a notary, you pay him 100 rupees, you will notarize it.
Yes. Yes, sir.
So, see, if you have influence, you can get it registered. It is better. But under the Registration Act, there is no requirement of registering an adoption deed. So, therefore, there is no mandate of law.
As in the case of a will, is it not?
Right.
As in the case of a will.
Suppose you are doing a tenancy for more than 11 months, you have to get it registered. You are selling and buying property, you have to get it registered, because there are requirements of the Registration Act. But for an adoption deed, you don't even have to write it. I agree with you. It is better in today's times to write it, to witness, have two independent witnesses and a notary to sign it. That's more than enough.
But he says registrar is insisting on court order.
Registrar is insisting on court order. He said, I will not sign unless there is a court order. So, is the problem.
Sir, you are a lawyer. All you have to do is go and meet the clerk of the registrar and find the easy way out, which is
yes, sir.
and between the lines, so many things are there
under the table.
Yes.
So, Advocate Munir ji, you have to approach the registrar to the right route.
Right, sir.
In India, I'm sorry, it is unfortunate. Everything is available for a fee.
Right.
So, it is not very difficult.
Okay, sir.
If you are NRI, rate is double. If you are not there, it is three times. in our jurisdiction, it is like this. So I think it is easily done. It's not an illegal act. You, at the most, what can the registrar say? Produce the persons. So persons being persons taking are produced. You carry a box of sweets, carry a small gift for the reader. Carry, please bless the child.
True, sir.
Now we have a asking with the question.
Yes, sir.
He's the law student.
So my question is, what is your take on LGBT adoption or gay couple adoptions?
Very simple question. Premnath can answer it. I don't think we are LGBT. See, hold on.
No, I think there is a decision by the Bombay High Court or something like that.
Hold on. I have actually missed out a very important thing, which I ought to have raised. And thank you, young man, for raising this issue. Now, there is a very interesting question which the adoption regulations have put across. So now, Regulation 5, talking about eligibility criteria for prospective adoptive parents, reads, the prospective adoptive parent shall be physically, mentally, emotionally stable, financially capable, and shall not have any life-threatening medical condition. Now, this is the gray area. Any prospective adoptive parents. Now, it doesn't say man and woman. It doesn't say unmarried. It doesn't say married. It doesn't say single. Irrespective of marital status and whether or not he or she as a biological son or daughter can adopt a child subject to the following conditions. Consent of both the spouses for adoption shall be required in case of a married couple. A single female can adopt a child of any gender. A single male child shall not be eligible to adopt a girl child. So now the question is, suppose I am a gay couple, suppose I am a single person, suppose I am a foreign national, suppose I am unmarried, can I adopt under the JJ Act? I can. Can I do this under surrogacy? I can't. Objective of parenthood is same, surrogacy and adoption regulations differ. But to answer your question, you cannot do it under HAMA, but you can do it under the JJ Act. Because they have said any prospective adoptive parents, it doesn't say citizens, it doesn't say adoptive couple, it says adoptive parents.
Gender neutral.
Gender neutral. LGBT, third gender also. Transgenders can also do it.
Correct.
So this is the conscious, this is why I say when they made the regulations, they have overridden the act also. I don't know whether this is good or bad, but this, the logic of the government is as many children as can be given in adoption, 20 million orphan children in India, as many can be sent in adoption, should go in adoption. So thank you, young man, for raising this question, which you have raised, and you have a wonderful scenery. I would like to visit this place with
backdrop. For your third house?
So, Arthur has put a very, very brilliant question. And before we go to Mr. KVJ Rao for the concluding remarks,
yes,
I would just sum up by saying that what the speaker today has addressed is that as of now, if we look at the legal provisions for adoption, we have different laws on the subject. Now, adoption of a child by an adult Hindu, it's governed by the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act of 1956. And the statute only governs the Hindus, which can include the Buddhists, the Jains and the Sikhs as well. And then we have the Guardian and Wards Act, which is applicable to the Christians, the Jews, Parsis and Muslims. But under the Guardian and Wards Act, the only relation that could be established after adoption, it's not that of a parent and child, but it may be of a guardian and ward. And in the case of adoption of the abandoned or the abused or the surrendered children, all inter-country adoptions, it can be done only as per the provisions of the Juvenile Justice Act of 2015 and the adoption regulations which are framed by the concerned authority. We also see that the Guardian and Wards Act it remains silent regarding the adoption of orphans and the abandoned or the surrendered children. And we have the CARA, the Central Adoption Resources Authority, which is a statutory body under the Ministry of Women and Children, Child Development, under the Government of India. And it functions as the nodal agency of the adoption of Indian children, and it monitors the in-country as well as the inter-country adoptions. And you have the path-breaking adoption regulations of 2017. And to sum up the judgments which were referred to by the speaker, he referred to Lakshmikant Pandey, an 84 Supreme Court decision of a three-judge bench, which is a landmark decision in the law relating to adoption, which laid down the normative and the procedural safeguards which are to be insisted in the inter-country adoptions, which again was clarified in Lakshmikant 2, 1986 Supreme Court, by the same three-judge bench, speaking through Justice Bhagavathy. Then you have Lakshmikant 4 during 1991, which issued further directions. And finally, you have Justice Ranjan Gogoi speaking for another three-judge bench in Shabnam Hashim's case, 2014, 4 SEC, page 1, where the Supreme Court recognizes the right to adopt and to be adopted as a fundamental right under Part 3 of the Constitution. So now over to you, Mr. K.V.J. Rao, for your aerial view of adoptions.
Thank you. Anil sir, excellent articulation. I mean, it's always been a pleasure to hear you, always like to hear you. And we are very happy that courts choose you as amicus curiae, because when you have to find a path, there's no other way than to get an uncontroversial, or should I say impartial, person to come there and give his views. But in all the talks that we had today or and earlier also, we have found that it is the legislature that is letting us down very badly. When they draft the laws, why don't they consult people like you, knowing that the courts have taken you as amicus curiae? That itself would be a recognition of some importance. I know the IAS or the bureaucracy would not want you there, but the fact remains is that somebody who's worked on ground in the field, been there, seen there, done it, why don't people consult you? What stops them? I mean, I know they draft rules, they call for suggestions, and a lot of suggestions must be going to them. How do they vet out the suggestions? I mean, nobody comes to know. But then a legislation comes which, rather than solving the issue, is an impediment to certain things. So how is it that we can control? I mean, I can't say control, but how can we streamline this process also needs to be addressed, sir. I mean, your articles, I keep reading your articles, so I know what it is. And I thank you very much for coming to this forum. But my sincere suggestion is, sir, that somebody needs to take it up with the government as to how you need to frame a law, or how you go about framing laws. Like, I am a victim of that myself. So, I mean, on June 6th, I'll be discussing it. Aviation laws, existence, evolution, existence, and the evading. So the thing is, why don't we have a system in place? So there is, like, you know, things are facilitated, things are done properly. That's all. And I thank you very much once again.
No, I think if you go by this thing, I think that the law is simple. The regulations, etc., guidelines provided, thereafter it causes the difficulties.
Why can't interpretation, sir?
Correct. Why can't they take the experience of a man at the cutting edge?
Also, the authorities created for the purpose of deciding it also have some role to play in it.
But those people don't know their elbow from the other part of the body. And I'm sorry I'm making this statement. But then, you take my case. I've got bureaucrats who come to the aviation who don't know what aviation is all about. And he brings his own team from outside. So the wall is already built. And that's a chakravyuh. If you get into the chakravyuh, you can't get out. They'll kill you there.
I have an input here.
Yes, sir.
When the English used to draft the laws, look at the CPC, look at the CRPC. I mean, these are all acts with worth their weight in gold.
Correct.
Why? Because they use in the in the secretariat here, there is a department of legislative drafting.
Correct.
In that department, I found when I drafted the Punjab Compulsory Registration of Marriages Act for the Government of Punjab, when I drafted the Punjab Prevention of Human Smuggling Act 2012 for the Government of Punjab, I found that there were draftsmen who were professionally trained.
Correct.
And involved people, as Mr. Rao is very rightly putting, experts who were in the field. So that is why laws came to be balanced laws. Today, what is happening? Clerks of bureaucrats draft a superintendent who doesn't know ABC, or a clerk who doesn't know, he will copy paste from here, there, and the law will come.
Erosion in standards everywhere.
No head, there is no soul, there is no body. So the Department of Legislative Drafting, which existed in the Secretariat, our Secretariat has come from Lahore, the Punjab Secretariat. So that Department of Legislative Drafting, which the English had as part of their backbone to the structure of laws, has gone. We have land laws, a land manual, Punjab Land Revenue Act of 1887. Look at the land laws we have in agrarian areas. They are still good. Why? Because they were made by legislative draftsmen. These legislative draftsmen were tuned to the policies of legislation, law, and drafting. I think that breed, that class of people
vanishing
has gone.
Vanishing. Yes.
So you have clerks. See, sorry to say, I hope.
Hey, even I don't know. Even I don't think that they are discussing with the law department regarding the.
Sir,
they are to be found in the law department only.
Sir,
Mohanlal.
I'll tell you what.
Mr. Mohanlal's father, Vishwanathan Nair, was a great draftsman.
Let me just give you an input here. There is an office of the legal remembrancer. Now, the remembrancer is a district judge. Now, that district judge is posted as legal remembrancer because he has to be shunted out of the judiciary. And that's unfortunately doesn't know ABC of anything.
I was one.
So legal remembrancer is sent 40 files, he signs all the files, and all the files come back. So the legal remembrancer honestly does not apply his mind to what has happened. Once the legal remembrancer signs, and the legal remembrancer, 9 times out of 10, I've seen it. The chief minister's office rings him up. We are sending this, please sign it. Who reads it? So the clerks draft, the bureaucrats sign. The bureaucrat is only interested where there is juice. If there is compensation coming, or there is money coming, or somebody is interested in particular law being made in a particular, this is reality.
Yes, sir.
So he will take the
job. They are all, they are nobody's a regulator, sir. They're all facilitators. Let me be very candid.
I'm Animal Hotra, maybe in other areas, but in Kerala, I think the law secretaries are doing a better role, because Justice Ramkumar was one who used sir, to put
education,
his note
education,
on that.
Education plays a role, sir. And the attitude to learn, listen to people, assimilate it, and to present it again is an art in itself, sir. Not everybody can do it.
Sir, I will give you an example. When the surrogacy regulation bill was made, it was referred to a select committee of the Rajya Sabha. So they picked up 23 honorable members of the upper house to hear observations, reactions, and views. I and my brother appeared before this committee. It was full of 20 very well-dressed people, and there were a lot of people from the ICMR and the ministry around them. None of these 20 people asked a question. It was all those babus sitting on the left and the right who were noting down everything. And they said, thank you, hello, and goodbye. That's all. And when the report came, obviously, nothing came out of it. So this exercise of this referring to a select committee was, I think, farce.
Same thing.
Because the government has already decided to ban surrogacy, because the government has already decided that this is going to be done. So this was a joke. What we really need to do is we need to revive the Department of Legislative Drafting by bringing in professional draftsmen who draft laws, to actually check the veracity of the laws, put it into test modules, and then enact the law. See, in now what is happening, when I was drafting this, the Home Secretary and the Chief Secretary, he says, now what we do, now we don't think about the law, we draft the law and we look at the law only after it goes to the High Court for validity being challenged. So we look at the law only after we make the law. We don't look at the law before we make the law. That is the problem.
Same thing, sir. So your Vande Bharat flights that are flying, the DGC has said, we have instituted a committee, medical committee, 23 people, 3 doctors. So you imagine what the committee is going to come up with. So they came up with saying that on ground you need social distancing of 3 feet. On the aircraft, you don't need it if you wear a PPE.
You can sit next to the air hostess also.
Yeah, also. Exactly, sir.
Too many cooks.
But unfortunately for us, the Bombay High Court approved it, but it is not being followed there also. So we are having a problem is when you make a rule, like the DGC issues a rule, nobody's thinking about it. The person who issues the rule doesn't even know the background.
So sir, let's look at it in the adoption matters. When they made the act, they amended the act, they took it to parliament. But when they made the regulations, the central government did it in consultation with the minister. Nobody even saw them. And in the bargain, they have overridden the act.
Correct.
This is what has happened.
Yes, sir. Everywhere, this is what is happening, sir. So, it's a standard practice.
And then you get a CEO who is no clue on law. He makes honey out of milk. Literally.
Ultra virus, the parent act.
I mean, I will just thank you again, once again, Anil, sir. It's really nice to listen to you. And we hope to hear from you again.
And I've given Primraj and Sham the next topic. Living in sin is not living in sin.
Yeah.
Live in is not living in sin.
Thank you.
So let us, over to you now. Let us learn to live in sin.
Great words.
We are just going back to our ancestors, sir.
So
why did Adam bite the apple?
Exactly.
Because he said.
Yeah.
Today we had a wonderful talk about adoptions.
Is it because Sham was not there, or is it because Prem was the host?
Because you have something important in this talk. Towards the end of the talk, the speaker, he turns into a real lawyer.
Oh.
He takes the case of the legal remembrancer and goes on to state about the skills of the legal remembrancer, in which he secures the admission of a former judge of the High Court, despite another former judge trying to save that particular judge from so admitting.
Don't say admission, confession.
I hold him to be in contempt. He has started looking like Modi with his beard growing. So I have doubts about
it. So anyway, that was a wonderful exposition of the adoption laws. And on our next section, we have Mr. Ram Mathav, who is a political analyst, who would be speaking on the topic, Judiciary Through the Political Lens. And we have to thank Justice Ramkumar and Justice Ramakrishnan, as well as all the participants for having made this talk, for having listened to this talk patiently. And we again thank the speaker of the day, Advocate Anil Malhotra. And till we meet again on 29th, stay safe and stay masked. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.